to join you in worship. And Lord, as always, help us never to forget that we worship before the audience of one. God, we ask, oh God, if we join you today, you are still the Lord thy God, the healer thee of all thy sicknesses and all of thy diseases. Lord, you are, and there is still balm in Gilead. We ask, oh God, that you will continue to bless whatever we do today. We do it to your glory and to your honor, that you may be praised. In the wonderful and awesome name of Jesus, all we ask, God, is you and give you praise. Amen. Give him glory. Give him praise. And give him glory. Hallelujah.
Thank you. your praises to the glory of God as we stand before the audience of one. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Obama here. So much is at stake in this election, from getting the pandemic under control, to building a fairer economy, to taking on climate change, to protecting our health care. You can change our direction on every issue. That's the power of your vote. History shows that the easiest way to make sure that you and your friends vote is to make a plan. And when it comes to voting this year, having a plan has never been more important. So I want to bring in my friend Brandon, who's going to tell us how to make sure our ballots count this year. Brandon, take it away.
Thank you, President Obama. Okay, North Carolina, this year you have three easy and convenient ways to cast your ballot and make your voice heard. You can vote early in person, vote by mail, or vote on Election Day on November 3rd. Voting early in person lets you vote on your schedule. Early voting sites will be open starting October 15th, and you can find yours at iwillvote.com/NC. To vote by mail, first go to iwillvote.com/NC to request your ballot today. Once you request your ballot, keep an eye on your mailbox. When your ballot arrives, follow the instructions carefully. Don't forget to grab a friend or a family member as your witness, and that you both complete the witness section on the return envelope. In North Carolina, you can mail your ballot or drop it off in person. Head here to track your ballot. And of course, you can vote early on Election Day, Tuesday, November 3rd. Go to iwillvote.com/NC to find your polling place. And don't forget, if you're in line by the time polls close, you can still vote. Back to you, President Obama.
Whether you vote by mail, vote early and in person, or vote in person on November 3rd, thank you for going to iwillvote.com and doing your part to protect this democracy and change this country for the better.
Now,
get out there and vote.
Get out there and vote.
Yeah, we got to work on that.
Good morning, Trinity. Good morning, family and friends. Wake up, wake up, wake up. If you're hearing us and receiving this on this Sunday morning, you're alive. That means God has kept you. If you can hear my voice, you can see my face, you're alive. This is the day God has made. You ought to rejoice and be glad. Amen. Thank you for joining us this morning as we come to worship on this Sunday morning. Or if you're watching this in the afternoon, thank you for joining us this afternoon as we continue to lift up the name of Jesus here at the Trinity AM Zion Church. Thank you for your support. Thank you for what you give to support us. We are so delighted to be able to bring this worship to you. The announcements will be on the screen following the worship today. Please govern yourself accordingly. I want to praise God for you, but I also want to pray for you. We send this greeting to all those who are listening. We send this greeting to our Bishop and Mrs. George in Battle, Jude, our missionary supervisor, Mrs. Alice, Senator Battle. We thank God for you. Sending a shout out even to folks that are in Florida, my mama, everybody. I want to thank God for all of you and pray God's blessings upon you. Be blessed by this worship today. Be blessed by what He provides for you. It comes from loving hearts and thankful spirits. I want to pray for you as you prepare to give in this offering time. Those who have been blessed by this ministry, we want you to please remember us in your giving. I want to also ask that you would please continue to remember those who are sick, who are shut in, destitute, bereaved, those who are struggling, those who are going through illnesses, whether it be physical, emotional, mental. I pray that God's blessings be upon us today, that we will receive what God has in store for us on this Sunday morning. Let's pray. God, I thank you for the privilege of sharing with my brother and my sister. And I pray, Lord, that you will bless, that you will pour out your spirit upon your people. And as we worship through giving, you will, O God, continue to supply our needs according to your particular glory by Christ Jesus. Bless gift and giver. Bless your word today. In Jesus' name. Amen. Welcome again. God bless you. Continue to practice safety measures that will sustain life. Because the life you save may be your own. I love you. Welcome to worship. Peace and
blessings. Good morning. My name is Raquel Blunt, and today I'll be reading the scripture, which is found in Psalms, 1st chapter, 1st through 6th verse. Blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the seat of mockers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever he does prospers. Not so the wicked. They are like chaff that the wind blows away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
As a deer, as a deer. Desire and I long.
pray with me. God, we thank you because in you there is no failure. And through you, oh God, we can do all things. In a world, oh God, that continues to throw its best at us through its worst, we thank you, oh God, that you continue to instill in us and enable us with power beyond our own. I thank you, Lord God, for the treasure you placed in earthen vessels so that the excellency of the power may be of you and not us. I pray now for preaching and teaching power, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart, the thoughts of my head, God, will reflect your desire for your people today. Save, heal, and deliver, we pray, God. Save, heal, and deliver, we pray, God. Save, heal, and deliver, we pray. Strengthen those, O God, who are weak. Build up those who are tossed and turning, trying to find their way through. We ask this, O God, now in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Our scripture text has already been read. I want to thank Sister Raquel Blunt for reading it for us on this Sunday morning. For the time that God was to share, I want to engage us sermonically from this thought. The stakes is high. Go on and type that. The stakes is high. As if to make a specific point regarding what would be priority upon entering this hymn collection of Hebrew poetry, the editors providentially and strategically choose Psalm 1 as the entry point into Israel's liturgical engagement with God on their patchy and checkered pilgrimage. Psalm 1 establishes what is paramount for Israel to navigate the capricious channels of remaining in solidarity with the one who has graced them with the awesome privilege and challenge of living in covenant fellowship with the Eternal. When you compare Psalm 1 to Psalm 150, you get the impression that the urgency for the editors of this section of Hebrew scripture was for Israel to have principle that would govern their praise. In other words, praise is more than just spasmodic, sporadic, emotive reaction to a rhythmic cadence. The placement of this psalm as the doorway into this collection is to establish the foundation. And that foundation is for there to be a meaningful relationship and experience with God. One must have principles that govern their practices. In other words, God is not moved by how we jump and shout. God is not moved by our emotional reactions. God is concerned about the principles that govern our lives. In other words, it's not how high I jump when I shout, it's how straight I walk when I come down. And so this lyrical doorway into the large and wild engagement with God is an invitation for people of faith to take seriously the demands of walking and living in truth. Psalm 1 is the acid test for authentic living beyond the cosmetic features of performance and presentation. Psalm 1 is asking, in the language of our ancestors, is you got good religion? It redefines what it means to be blessed. It deconstructs blessing, and it continues to establish for those who would be blessed that the blessings are not the incidents of material gain and positional prominence. It takes blessings, watch me, beyond the Western confines of cars, cribs, cash, commodities, conveniences, connections, and commerce. And I believe that in this day and age in which we live, as we press our way into November 3rd and beyond, I really believe that an honest conversation with Psalm 1 is necessary. Before we get busy or busier into being active in the struggle for justice and wrestling through the crippling
crippling disparities that we have been faced with over the past 7 months, and in many cases for centuries, I believe it's necessary to give new perspective to an old passage, and Psalm 1, my friends, is necessary. And dear friends, I want to be forthright as forthright as I can as we share in this sermonic conversation, because without question, we are at a critical point in the history of this nation. Most especially, we are at a critical point and a crucial crossroad in salvation history. I cannot stress enough how serious these next few weeks will be for all who are concerned about the future of our collective life as a people, and dare I say it, as the church. And I must confess to you that I come to this preaching moment with a weird mix of prophetic anger and faithful dismay. I'm watching friends struggle with losing loved ones, and family fretting over loved ones who have tested positive for this nefarious virus. I'm watching with sheer horror and disgust the ramming of a Supreme Court nominee by a rogue and ratchet Republican Senate majority, while millions languish in squalor, unemployment, and without a place to lay their heads. I cringe when hearing the shameless politicizing that is gut-punching the hopes and aspirations of so many, while the few are shoring up their reserves, and hoarding resources that are so desperately needed by the masses. I wince when I see the election tampering occurring within and beyond our borders in the name of greed, avarice, and supremacy. And I seethe with anger when I hear stories of voter disenfranchisement, voter suppression, and voter intimidation taking place all over the country, and especially in the state of North Carolina. And as COVID-19 numbers climb, and in many cases skyrocket to new highs, and the resources to treat cases sink to depressingly basement lows, I find myself retreating to this text and inviting those whose lives are governed by it to re-examine what it essentially means to be a principled people. As you know, attacks on the integrity of the electoral system and the gutting of the Voter Rights Act, disinformation campaigns, foreign interference, and more have weakened the overall structure and has cast doubt and dismay upon the results. We're seeing repeated attempts through propaganda and other means and methods to further undermine the system and discredit in advance the results of this election. And what do I say? Psalm 1. The occupant at the White House has attempted to co-opt real concerns about the upcoming election, claiming without real evidence that it might be stolen as a result of fraud tied to vote by mail. And his efforts deflect attention away from the ways that voter suppression efforts already underway pose a real danger both to people who seek to exercise their hard-won right to vote and to the integrity of the electoral system itself. And someone is asking, what do you say about that? Someone. A careful survey of history reveals that since the passing of the Voter Rights Act in 1965, there have been systematic efforts made to exclude Americans of color from the voting process. You remember in 2013, in the Shelby County versus Holder ruling, the Supreme Court gutted the Voting Rights Act, rolling back 20 years of provisions that were aimed at registering and protecting voters, particularly people of color. And the court's ruling declared essentially that racism was a thing of the past, and in result became one of the severest blows to to American democracy. More than half the states passed voter suppression measures that represent new forms of Jim Crow, including stricter voter ID laws, limits on polling locations, the purging of voting rolls, and more. And what do I say to it? Some more. Can I push it? The current president has engaged in direct attacks on this process. His attacks on voting by mail were amplified by the Republican National Committee and conservative groups, including evangelical groups, which are spending tens of millions of dollars on strategies to limit the expansion of absentee voter. While voter fraud tied to vote by mail is a politically manufactured fairy tale, states will see a gush in absentee ballots and likely experience stoppages and challenges due to a lack of experience and inadequate infrastructure as a result. And what do you say, Mitchell?
Someone.
When you see right before your very eyes children and parents struggling to determine whether or not they're going to eat or sleep without enough money to take care of the basic necessities of life, and we sit and watch how people move without masks and go out moving cavalierly without regard for human life, while people are losing their lives in droves, and all we say is that I want to do my thing my way. What are you saying, Mitchell?
Psalm 1. I think it's important and strategic that the first book, the first chapter, the first psalm, the prayer book of the temple, the prayer book of the Bible, the hymnal of ancient Israel, opens up not about a poem about praising. That's in Psalm 50. But in Psalm 1, the opening psalm tells us nothing to do when it comes to praise. But it puts praise at ground level. It puts praise where praise should begin. In our ethics, our lifestyle, and our decisions. It is as if the claim is being shared and the gauntlet has been thrown and the line has been drawn. Before we bother praising and worshiping, before we engage in sanctified calisthenics, the goal of Psalms is a changed life. In other words, God says before you get to shouting and before you get to promenading and before you get to doing everything in performance, God wants to know, is your heart in tune and are your ethics lined up with God's eternal yes and God's eternal now? In other words, before we move into celebration, God requires a decision. Make a choice. And that's why we're camping out at the doorway of Psalm 1, because we don't need praise and worship if we're not ready to make crucial decisions. God raises the question, and you and I must answer it. Do you walk in the counsel of the ungodly, or do you delight in the law of the Lord? Once the choice is framed this way, it's no choice at all, is it? I mean, you would never knowingly choose evil or destruction. You wouldn't choose to jump over a cliff. You would sit down to an extravagant dinner with those you love. You wouldn't choose to ruin your life. You would choose to fulfill your purpose. Sounds easy, right? But if the choice is so easy, Trinity, why then do we find our ears perking up to the whispering of wickedness? And why would our attitude toward the law of the Lord not be honestly characterized as a delight? But the counsel of the wicked, listen to it, the counsel of the wicked sounds sneaky, doesn't it? I mean, come on, come on. The devil doesn't jump out
in a red suit breathing fire and holding a blazing pitchfork. No. The devil dresses up attractively, offering glaring propositions and attractive and alluring opportunities. Platinum plans. Insulation from responsibility. Tax cuts and tax breaks. The psalmist is saying that in order to really get to the heart of what moves God, you have to put this matter right in front of you, and the psalmist is wise enough to put right in our faces so as to make us wrestle with the contradictions we all live with. We all talk about the good life, don't we? And the good life is defined by some in the culture in ways that mimic the good life that God offers, but yet it's different enough to fool us. Part of the quandary is this. Robert Frost wrote, two roads diverge in a yellow wood, and sorry that I could not travel both. But we think we can travel both, don't we? And not only both, but other roads as well. I'm in a clearing, he says, four roads diverge, and I can't miss a thing. I'll take all four. But we cannot take all four, because you wind up splintered, divided, and out of focus. Really, what the text is teaching us is that if there's going to be forward movement in a space where people are trying to pull us back, you've got to have a posture that is not moved by the incidents and the nefarious accidents that occur and are occurring on a daily basis. Now this morning, let me confess. The reason why I'm sitting in this chair is not simply because I'm trying to have a conversation with you this morning. The real truth is, I've been having some problems. I've been having some itises and atticas. I've had sciatica and bursitis. Yes, I said it. Confession may not be good for the reputation, but it's good for my soul. And I've been nursing it for the past 2 weeks. And I've discovered after closely monitoring my life that part of the reason, perhaps, that I'm suffering with this trouble now is because I didn't listen to my mama when I was young. And she's listening to me right now. I'm sure she's saying, uh-huh. She would tell me all the time, stop slouching. Has anyone ever heard that admonition before? Stop slouching. Sit up straight. Don't sag. She was trying to teach me a lesson that many, if not all of us, struggle with now. And that is, write this down, your posture matters. Your posture matters. I think that's what the psalmist is teaching us in this psalm. Your posture will bless you or curse you. Your posture will propel you, or it will and can disable you. But not only that, you gotta be careful with the people you position yourself with. I wish I had time to talk, because so much of what we're seeing and so much of what we have seen in this country comes out of our inability to make the right decisions and to take the right positions and to have the right posture. And could it be, my brothers, blessed is the person, watch it, posture, that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stand in the way of sinners, nor sit in the seat of scoffers. Posture, 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 posture. Walk based on the advice of the wicked. Stand in the way of those who commit sins against people and sins against the marginalized, and sins against the poor, and sins against the widow, and sins against the dispossessed, or sit in the seat of scoffers, those who scorn and scoff when there are those stand for right and stand for justice and stand for peace. Watch it, he says, your position matters. And because I've had poor posture, and because I've spent a lot of time, come on, lounging, stooping, drooping, bowed down, slouching, it hurts when I walk. It hurts when I stand. It hurts when I sit. And so I'm taking greater consideration when it comes to my posture. This morning, what is your posture? Because you're not going to navigate this space if you're all over the place and you behold to everything everybody tells you. If there's going to be a consistent attempt to thwart the very powers of evil, then the church must return to a posture that is positioned by God and God's word. Watch it. Because I think the church has been slouching for years. I think the church has been slouching under the notion that if we have the right people in our pews, and if we have the right music in our church, and if we have the right personalities in our constituency, if we made the right deals and had the right relationships and made the right connections and have all the things that make for what we call success, then we could parade around as successful people and blessed people. And can I tell you something, brothers and sisters? When we trade in our integrity for popularity, we begin to slouch. The church has traded its identity, its integrity, for being like those who have ultimately duped us into thinking that success outwardly replaces integrity inwardly. Oxenham is right: to every man there openeth a way, ways and the way, and the high soul climbs the highway, and the low soul gropes the low. And in between on the mystery flats the rest drift to and fro. But to everyone there openeth a highway and the low, and everyone must decide the way their soul shall go. What is your soul posture? Where are you? What are you for? No, not your money. What are you for? No. Not your gifts, not your abilities. What are you for? What is your inside? Thank you, Howard Thurman, a blessed memory. What is your inside span? What can you be called upon to stand on when everybody else is taking sides and taking side deals and taking bets and placing their loyalties in unfriendly and ungodly relationships? Monitor your posture. Because, beloved, the stakes is high. And when you look at it in its realest sense, you and I have been placed strategically in a position where we cannot go from left to right. We cannot waffle. We cannot vacillate. We've got to stand firm. Lives are hanging in the balance, and issues of significance are at stake. No slouching. No deal making that cuts out the poor and the dejected. No slouching. No sidebar chatter that puts the mission at risk. The stakes is high. No slouching. As a matter of fact, if you see your brother and sister sagging under this uniquely heavy load, be an encourager today. Tell them, no, you can't slouch. You can't bow. You can't bend. You can't genuflect at the altar of expediency. God is requiring for us to take a stand. No slouches allowed. If I had a church full of folk, and if I were able to welcome you into this space, I'd put a sign outside these doors saying, no slouchers! We don't need slouchers. And we've got some slouchers. We've got some people that will sell their soul for a mess of pottage. Bless is that person who will not take posture with the ungodly, but will delight
in what gets God going. That's what that text means. But will delight in what God loves. And can I tell you what God loves? God loves. Can I tell you what really turns God on? God gets turned on when we begin to delight in God's law. Can I tell you what God's law is? God's law is the law of love. God's law is being able to love in the face of hate. God's law is being able to stand firm in the face of glaring obstacles. God gets turned on when we delight in the law of the Lord. In other words, take pleasure in God's law. No, not take pleasure in laws that disenfranchise the many. No, take pleasure in law, the law of God, which puts everybody on equal footing. Laws that promote equity and fairness and justice. Laws that give opportunity for all of God's children. God's law is when we open the floodgates and we remove the margin and we begin to invite those who have been left out to be brought in. That's the law of God. And I'm wondering, are we ready to take on the mantle of responsibility and quit sitting around irking and jerking and shirking our responsibility and begin to see that the stakes are too high for us to sit around and waffle and complain and murmur, but the delight of my soul should be in the law of the Lord. And watch this, he says, and on his law, he murmurs it. He internalizes it day and night. Because when you have the right posture, God will put you in a providential position. In other words, when you have the right posture, you don't have to worry about the ungodly coming after you. You don't have to worry about the ungodly coming to assail and assault you, because there's a providential promise in this text of providential positioning, that God puts us in a providential position. And they shall be like trees. You're not there because somebody put you in that position. You're there because God planted you. Now, if somebody puts you in that position, then you need to be beholden to them, be loyal to them, and praise them. But I wish I had one or two folk who are looking at me right now who can testify that where I am, God put me. What I know, God taught me. Where I've been, God brought me. What I have, God gave me. And because I got what I got and God gave it to me, my loyalty is not to anybody. My loyalty is not to a system. God, I wish I had more energy. My loyalty is not to some bureaucrat. My loyalty is not to some party. My loyalty is not to some supremacist. My loyalty is to the one who has kept me from the early rockings of my cradle to my present moment, and through many dangers, toils, and snares, he has brought me. He has kept me. He has sustained me. And I'm going to be where God put me. So if you're going to do anything, don't you move because somebody gets mad. Don't you get upset because folks come at you. No. Remember, when you've been planted by God, God will hold you. God will keep you. And God will sustain you. Somebody say, I'm planted. And when God plants me, I ain't going nowhere. When God has put me, I ain't going nowhere. Let them try to come against me. I don't care what you bring. I've got the promise of God that says no weapon formed against me shall prosper because I've been planted. And look at y'all, I like this thing. I'm getting happy. I like this text because this text tells me something. This text tells me that where God plants me, there's an endless stream. So I don't have to worry about where my help is coming from. Because where, thank you, Holy Ghost, where God has planted me, God is sustaining me. I get tired. I get frustrated. I get mad when I see what I see. I get mad when I hear what I hear. But I got to remember something. I want to share with you too. That when God plants protects you. God never promises that things are not going to come and seasons are not going to come and go. But the fact that you've been providentially planted outweighs what may come your way. Come on, help me, God. Yes, I know seasons are coming. This is a tough season. This is a difficult season. Yes, it is. And we're going to see some even tougher seasons because we're not leaving this space anytime soon. We've got some long roads ahead. We've got a long march ahead. But can I tell you something? With all that we will face, if we would remain planted, because yes, I'm going to be a tree, because I'd rather be a tree that's anchored than to be chaff that's not anchored. I'd rather be a tree that's anchored than to be chaff, because the Bible does say this, doesn't it? That the ungodly will not have an anchor. That no matter what they do and what they try, everything they do will come to naught because there is no anchoring. But because I've been planted, thank you, Holy Ghost, and because I've been planted by God, yes, the season will come and go, but God knows how to prosper me even in seasons that are not favorable. This is not a favorable season. God, I wish I had the energy. This is not a favorable season. But can I tell you something? Just because the season is not favorable doesn't mean God doesn't give me favor. Come on, come on, come on, come on. The seasons around me and the climate around me may not be favorable, but my God, help me, is faithful. Somebody ought to help me and just type faithful. That our God is faithful. That I know I've not been faithful to God, but I thank God that God has been faithful to me. That although I've been slouching, I'm still thankful that I got my health and strength. I'm able to move around. I may not be able to move the way I want to move, but I thank God that I still have range of motion, and so I'm not going to complain about what it's not, because what is greater than what is not, and the Lord is blessing me right now. He says, the ungodly are not so. Therefore, the ungodly cannot stand in the congregation of the righteous. But the Lord knows and embraces the way of the righteous. And in other words, God embraces those who will stand for what is right and what is just, and will not be lured into the temptation of being accepted by a few. He says, the Lord, I'm finished, knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly is lost. I know you've been watching the debates, and I know you got mad about what you saw, and I know you got mad about the things that took place, but I got redemption from a fly the other week, that although it looked as if one candidate was trying to take advantage of the other, and I started getting mad, and I started getting upset when my sister girl was being disrespected. Yeah, y'all can call her a monster. And the vice presidential candidate treated her like one. But I got redemption from a fly. And that fly let me know, that fly started preaching to me. Because I almost got mad and went through the television. But I got redemption this past week because God reminded me, I know what's going on. Don't you think for a moment that I can't see what's happening? And as I hasten to my close, yes, I need to remind somebody that it is rough and it is tough, but please allow me to enforce and reinforce what the crux of this text is really about. That the crux of this text is about the power of God in the midst of pessimistic parents. Because you do know this text is written to marginalized African Edenic Yahwistic Jews who find themselves in the minority. And they start asking and wondering whether God is with us or not. And whether or not God is going to help us out of this situation. That's the reason why this psalm, this book of Psalm, begins with Psalm 1, reminding us that it's in your lifestyle. It's in your decisions that before you do anything, before you lift your hand to praise God, remember you got to make a decision to live for God. Because there will be times that you don't feel like praising God. There will be times you don't feel like lifting up your hands. There will be times you don't feel like praising God with the timbrel and the dance. There will be times where you can't come in the sanctuary and lift up holy hands and praise God on the praise team. There are times, I said I wasn't going this far, but I might as well come on and go. And you come on, go with me. There will be times you don't know whether or not you're going or coming. But there are some things that my praise can never do for me. There's some things that praise can't get me out of. And when I can't lift my voice and give God a praise, when I don't feel like shouting, I gotta make a decision that through it all, I'm gonna learn how to live for the Lord. I may not feel like being on top, and I may not feel like lifting my hands, but I made up in my mind that there's some things I may not have to feel already.
We never close our worship without giving you an opportunity to receive Christ. So that person who needs a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, if you would simply reach out to us, you can email us or you can call us. The information will be on your screen. We'd love to usher you into a saving relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Or if you're looking for a church home, and it doesn't matter where you live on the planet, we'd be glad to have you as a part of our eChurch family. Simply reach out to us, call us, write us, email us. We'll be glad to have you as a part of our family. My prayer is that you will continue to have a powerful, positive, and productive week as you continue to live life with purpose and on purpose. And until we gather again in space together, the Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of God's countenance upon you and give you peace, now, henceforth, and forevermore. And the blessed people of God said, amen, amen, amen. God bless you. I love you. Stay safe. Wear your mask. Register to vote. Make sure you take care of yourselves. I love you. Peace.